Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Futurama with Nerds. I'm your host, Alex Billings. With me is my co-host, Ryan Lechnoise.
Hello.
All right, and today we're going to be doing episode 212, Raging Bender, which originally aired February 27th in 2000 and was written by Lewis Morton.
Are we gotten to the point where it's mostly the same writers coming back, like the core element?
I mean, in general, at this point, yeah, there's been mostly just the main writers.
Yeah, like we've seen Ken Keeler a handful, but it's...
Well, Lou Morton is one of the regulars, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this episode opens, like most of them, at Planet Express.
Yeah, no more cold opens, which is nice.
Yeah, I can't say for sure there's not going to be any more, but it's definitely not every episode anymore.
Yeah,
so it opens up there. The big thing is they're having a meeting, and Hermes comes back from vacation and he's got a brain slug on, which we have seen before in the A Head in a Poles episode.
Oh, brain slugs were in that one. I forgot about that.
Yeah, they were one of the political parties.
That's right.
But they ask him how his vacation was to whatever planet. I don't remember where he was supposed to be going.
Yeah.
And he's like, there was a layover on the brain slug planet. Hermes liked it so much he decided to stay of his own free will. Basically, he's got a brain slug that's now controlling his body.
Yep. I like the brain slugs.
Yeah, and Fry starts to bring it up, and then, Fry, shut up. You're going to get us all assimilated. And Hermes is like, anyways, your orders for today are to go to the brain slug planet. They're like, what are we going to do there? Just walk around without a helmet. And they're all like, oh, yes, yes. And Professor just whispers over. He's like, let's ditch him and go to the movies. To which they all agree, and they're all excited to do. And they leave and get up, and Hermes just sitting there at the table going,
Yeah, fully control, but like not even well hidden, which is the best part.
Yeah, they talked a bit about how they were debating having Hermes have a brain slug for a whole season.
I'm kind of glad they didn't.
Yeah, they said at the time they just thought it'd be funny, but ultimately they're like, it wasn't as funny as we thought.
Yeah, the joke would like, it would fall flat after a couple episodes for sure.
Yeah, exactly. It was good for an episode.
Yeah.
So they go to the movie theater and they're all debating about what movie to go see. I will actually say they do have the name of the movie theater has one of their high level math jokes.
Oh, what was it? I didn't notice it.
It's a weird symbol that I'd never seen before, plex.
Okay.
And I guess it's an all of not plex, which is a math term, which is a term for an infinity, but a small infinity. The way they explained it, they said basically it's an infinity of all known numbers.
Okay, gotcha. So it's not quite infinity because there's numbers that we don't know, but it's every number we do know, which is essentially infinity. But it's,
yeah,
okay, I can see it from layman's terms. Clearly I'm not understanding it to the same extent that they would, but
yeah, again, in the commentary they're talking about it and they're like, that might be the nerdiest joke ever in a sitcom. And then David X. Cohen's like, ironically though, it's only the 15th nerdiest joke ever in Futurama.
Yeah, that's a neat little one that I didn't even notice what the theater was called.
Oh yeah, I mean, I didn't notice either until the commentary, right? But yeah, all the crew are all arguing over which movie to see. Like, Fry wants to go see Galaxy Wars, which the poster is clearly a Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
They're like, no, I don't want to see a historical documentary. And Leela wants to see Smizmar. Or no, sorry, Quizblorg.
Yeah, Smizmar is something completely different.
Well, no, there's a different movie that they don't talk about that is When a Man Loves a Smizmar.
Okay.
Which is the first use of Smizmar.
Which is clearly a reference to When a Man Loves a Woman.
Yeah, she wants to see Quizblorg, which is, I guess, like a, looks like probably a romantic period piece from the poster, but they're like amoeba people.
Yeah.
And, you know, Amy doesn't want to see a movie with subtitles, and then Zoidberg suggests Planet of the Clams, which is clearly Planet of the Apes, just with lobster people and clams.
Yeah.
And then finally, Bender just says, let's see All My Circuits, the movie, and they all agree to that. So they go in. Bender goes and gets popcorn with motor oil on it. And they have, like, the nerdy teen character, like, robot working there, and he has acne, his little glowing dots.
Yeah. It's like Christmas lights on his face almost.
That kind of sucks for him. That's built into him.
Yeah, I guess he could probably get them removed later on, but yeah, it's kind of funny.
It's one of those things where they're like, who's building robots like this? Why did they need to give him acne?
Yeah, Mom makes some weird choices, but it's like, we need... My thought, especially for this one, it's like, okay, we're going to build a robot whose job is to work at the theater. What are most people comfortable having serve them at a theater? Well, most of the time it's teenagers, so let's make a robot that kind of resembles a teenager to work at the theater. Yeah. That would be my justification for it, but I mean, we see a ton of robots that don't make any sense, like Fatbot, for example.
Yeah.
Why is Fatbot a thing?
Exactly. There's no reason for him to be fat.
No. And they even make that reference later on, a joke in this episode.
Yeah. So they go into the theater and it starts with like a newsreel like they would have in the 40s in movie theaters.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, little things like they have the Mrs. Universe from a little while ago, and she's, you know, visiting the troops who are trying to destroy all humans on the Paramecium homeworld.
Yeah. They have the mayor opening a new tube line to alleviate traffic. It just shows a bunch of people stuck in the tubes.
Yeah. And then it shows the Ultimate Robot Fighting League, which here it looks kind of like boxing.
Yeah.
But it's the masked unit fighting. I don't remember what the other one's name was. Gorgeous something, I think.
Yeah, he's beating them up.
And then he like melts them with eye lasers.
I have to say, I'm slightly disappointed in the acronym for the Ultimate Robot Fighting League, because they could have got rid of the fighting part and had it be a URL and make that joke.
Oh, yeah.
But they had to have the F in it to ruin that, because I thought it would have been cool if it was just URL, but...
Yeah, that's a good point, actually, though. I never thought about that.
My nerdy joke for this episode is like it should have just been a URL as opposed to URFL, but...
Yeah. And then they start getting closer to the movie and a robot couple comes in and they sit right in front of Bender and the guy's like head is really tall. So Bender asks him if he could take his head off and he's like, sorry, sir, I needed to watch the movie.
Yeah, he's like a super polite, nerdy.
Yeah, he's kind of like thin and scrawny. He's not scrawny because he's still like tall and kind of big, but he's got like little thin arms and
tall, skinny dude, essentially, who's like really meek, I guess would be the term.
Yeah, and Bender like makes fun of his girlfriend calling her fat and stuff.
Yeah, should have stopped halfway in production.
Yeah, and then the movie begins and it has like a James Bond opening.
This I had this thought when watching it. What is All My Circuits? I know it's based on...
All My Children All My would be Children. The name, but it's just any generic soap opera.
Yeah, but like if we're actually trying to follow the story of All My Circuits, there's some like, is it action soap opera? Is it like, what is it about?
This is the only thing that really makes it action. Usually it is very soap opera-y anytime you see it. Yeah. It's lots of like evil twins and betrayal and someone's cheating on someone and someone's back from the dead and stuff like that.
Yeah, but then this one was very clearly like the James Bond opening.
Yeah.
And then like it's your choose your own adventure, but he just does paperwork the whole time.
Yeah, because it's Calculon's doing paperwork and then Claudette calls him to, not Claudette, that's a different character. I can't remember her name. Anyways, the woman from All My Circuits calls him and is like, oh, there's an action sequence just broke out at the special effects warehouse. It's like, you better get down here quick. And then he's like, I have no choice but to. And it stops and it's a choose your own adventure. And a little voice comes on. It's like, if you'd like Calculon to go to the laser battle in his Ferrari, press one. If you'd like him to double check his paperwork, press two. Then Fry, like at his chair, pushes one. And then the voice like, you've pressed two.
No, I didn't.
I'm almost certain that you did. And then he starts doing the paperwork again.
What I like about this is when it cuts to him doing the paperwork, it then cuts to the audience, and they're enjoying watching him do the paperwork. Like, if you see Fry, he's enjoying watching Calculon redo his paperwork, which I thought was kind of clever. Also, I like in the opening credits for the movie that everything is based on, like, directed by directing unit 18, written by written unit 12, but then there's, like, Joe Estrada as the writer as well.
There's, like, one or two regular names, but yeah, it's mostly robots, like, writing unit.
Yeah.
Original character unit.
Yeah. And then again, Joe Estrada or whatever his name was.
When they do for the little voice that comes out to be like, pick your number or whatever, it's actually played by the movie phone guy.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I guess Russ Leatherman.
That's pretty cool.
But yeah, he was the actual movie phone guy that they got to do that.
That's pretty neat. That's a neat little tidbit right there.
Yeah. But then they have Bender just kind of being an asshole. He's kicking the seat of the guy in front of him, just humming, kicking the seat. The guy turns around and asks him to stop. He says he will, but then he turns back and he just starts doing it again right away. Starts throwing popcorn at the back of his head. So then the guy gets up. He's like, that's it, sir. I challenge you to fisticuffs. And Bender's like, sure, laughing at him. But then he like, his chest puffs out and his arms grow bigger. And Bender's like, oh, I'm boned.
Yeah, he essentially transforms into a massive monster of robots.
And the guy shoots lasers at him and everyone starts panicking and running away, and Bender's running. He gets cornered. While he's running, though, he drops his popcorn, and the big robot's coming up, and he slips on the motor oil from the popcorn and falls and knocks himself out. And then Leela comes up and she reveals, like, Bender, do you know who that was? And pushes the thing, and his chest opens up, and it's like the masked unit.
Obviously, they had the URFL fighting champion at this point.
Yeah, exactly. And then they have a guy run up who's the commissioner of the Ultimate Robot Fighting League, who just happens to be there, I guess.
Well, he's an aficionado of picking jerks out of movie theaters.
Yeah.
And by far, Bender is the biggest jerk ever.
Which I don't think he gets named in this episode, but his name is Abner Double Deal.
He's definitely not named in this episode, then.
He does come back. But yeah, so he wants to recruit Bender. And then, you know, we have our first commercial break.
End of Act 1, and then we get into the Bender as the Ultimate Fighting League robot fighter thing.
Yeah, because when it comes back, they're back at Planet Express, and he's all excited about it, and everyone else is telling him not to do it, because like, you're going to get killed.
Yeah.
But Leela's like, no, you have to do it. It's about pride. She tells a story from when she was a high school kid, how she was taking martial arts, and it shows her, and she's like beating up these two guys. But then the master, who's like this little green alien guy with like bug eyes.
Yeah.
It's just like, William, Hank, congratulations. You'll be going on to the championship. Hank, congratulate Will when he regains consciousness. And Leela's just like, what do you mean? I won. And he's like, yes, but you're a girl, so you don't have the will of a warrior. Only boys have the will of a warrior, so you lose.
Yeah, essentially being super sexist about why Lethal is not allowed to compete.
Yeah, and that's what it is. His name's Master Fnog.
Fnog.
But yeah, that's all it is. It's just he's saying she can never really be a winner because she's a girl.
Yeah.
Only men can win. So Leela's going to train Bender so that he can win in the Robot League. So they show a bit of his training, like get him to try to touch his toes, but his body just falls off and then he still can't reach his toes.
Yeah, a montage of him being bad at stuff. Yeah.
Which also makes no sense, though, because they've shown he has extendo arms before.
Yep, he could have just done that. But yeah, montage of how Bender is clearly not very athletic and will probably lose horribly, horribly, horribly.
Yeah, and then they get him to his first fight, and it's against his opponent's called the Clear Cutter. It's like a lumberjack-themed wrestler.
Yep.
And he's got one hand as an axe and one hand as a chainsaw. And like in the audience, we have the rest of the crew watching. Leela's down there with him as like his coach, but the rest of them are watching. And Hermes is trying to get Fry to put a brain slug on. He's like, I bought you a hat. Fry goes to take it. He just realizes like, hey, wait a minute, and gives it back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then Bender and the Clear Cutter start fighting and Bender's getting his ass kicked. He gets like the axe stabbed in his back.
And they make the axe hole joke.
Yeah. He gets like tossed over to Leela and she's like, Bender, you can't give up. Every time you get an axe in the back, and then he gets pulled away and you hear a drill and comes flying back and there's a hole in his forehead. She's like, or a drill to the face. Now stop scratching your axe hole and get in there.
Yeah.
And he goes in and he tries to like kick, but his leg wraps around his own neck and then sticks forward, and the Clear Cutter tries to like bounce off the ropes, basically goes flying at him, and his head hits the leg, falls down, and his body blows up. And so, you know, they're celebrating because he won. And then in the locker room, he's like, I did it. It's like, I think he's dead. I took a life.
So proud of himself.
Yeah, but then Clear Cutter just walks in the door. He's like, hey, dude. Walks by, and Bender's all confused. And then Abner Double Deal comes in and he's like, explains to him robot fighting's fixed. Right? The most popular person always wins. He's like, well, I just won because I'm popular. And he's like, yeah. He's like, I'm popular.
Yeah.
And there's basically a montage of Bender fighting all the other robot wrestlers.
Well, I like the joke when he's explaining that, like, well, no, that's later on. But yeah, it's essentially we get the switch of we thought we were watching boxing, a mixed martial art, and it turns out we're watching wrestling.
Well, Fry says, he's like, I thought robot wrestling was real, like pro wrestling, but turns out it's fixed, like boxing.
Which is a great little joke.
Yeah, Fry's stupid.
Yep.
So Bender goes through the gambit of robot wrestlers. So there's Billionaire Bot, super rich, and he actually comes back a decent amount. Billionaire Bot. Most of the other ones don't, or once or twice. There's the Foreigner.
I like the Foreigner because he just turns and goes, I'm not from here.
Yeah, the Foreigner's probably the funniest one in this episode. I'm not from here. I have my own customs.
Look at my crazy passport.
And he's dressed up like a matador.
Just generic Foreigner. I like that.
Yeah, the Chain Smoker, who's like a cigarette vending machine, and then he blows smoke all over the audience. Yeah,
after this, I'm going to go to your favorite restaurant.
Yeah, basically, it's all the heels, right?
Yeah, and Bender gets to be the face of the industry, beating up the heels that nobody likes.
Yeah, and he's called Bender the Offender.
Yeah, he's just an ex-con trying to change his ways and get his kids back.
Yeah, and then, he keeps winning all the fights. Obviously, they're all staged fights is the idea. And then they show him them back at Planet Express, and Leela wants him to go work out, but he comes in, he's like wearing a fur coat with a couple of like fembots with him as his floozies, keeps calling them. And he's like, I don't need to train. He's like, it's all like, I'm going to win all the time. Basically just saying he doesn't care anymore.
Yeah.
And Leela gets mad that he doesn't want to work. So he goes back to the Robot Wrestling League and he comes in and he's trying to pitch the idea of him mud wrestling with the two floozies, and they're like, no, that's not what we're gonna do. And he's like, what if I told you we weren't fighting in the conventional sense? But then they basically explain to him it's Abner and all the other robot wrestlers are all there for some reason.
Yep.
And they're explaining that he's not selling enough merchandise.
Yeah, his scented bath bombs aren't working.
Well, yeah, that's one, like the scented bath bombs. And he's like, I told them T-Berry, this is sandalwood. And he's like, damn it, Bender, if you can't move sandalwood, you don't belong in this league.
Which I thought was funny. Yes. Like that's the level, the cutoff of success. You have to be able to sell sandalwood.
Yeah. He's like, but people love me. He's like, they love you now. It's like, we'll see how they love you in your new persona, the gender bender. And he has like a tutu, which I gotta say is probably a role they wouldn't give today as the super negative thing.
No, but they kind of almost save it when they're like, watch him attack your sexuality and stuff like that.
Yeah, but
like,
but I'm just saying that feels a little dated.
It's a bit dated, but it still works. It's not, I don't think it's overly offensive, but
yeah. But Bender's like, well, what if I just refuse to lose? And he's like, then the new guy will have to beat you the old-fashioned way to death.
Yeah,
puts on his little like speaker box and he's like, send in the new guy. And he busts through the wall and it's this big giant robot and he's like, I am Destructor.
The first instance of Destructor, because he does come back quite a bit.
Destructor also comes back and then it just cuts back and Bender's putting on the tutu and he's like, see you at the fight.
Yeah, Destructor is great.
Yeah, it's the end of Act 2. Come back with them at Planet Express again and he's like, he's explaining to everyone what happened. He's like, and then I said, I'll see you at the fight. And he's all upset because he's like, I don't want to do this. He's like, it's one thing to win a fixed fight. There's dignity in that, but to lose?
Yeah, Bender all about the winning. Doesn't matter how.
Yeah, and he wants Leela to train him again. And she's like, no, If you wouldn't take my help when you didn't need it, why would I give it to you now when you do need it? And the professor points out, he's like, what are you talking about?
That's stupidly.
Yeah. She's like, doesn't matter, I'm not helping. Turns the TV on and it's a advertisement for the upcoming fight between the genderbender and Destructor. You see Destructor though, and he's there with his coach, and it turns out to be Master Fnog from when Lilo was a kid, and she's all mad about that, so she agrees to train him for that reason. So she's like, Bender, I'm gonna teach you to fight like a girl. He's like, I'll put on my tutu.
All right, hard cut to the fight.
Yeah, just cuts to the fight.
They already had their training montage. They don't need a second training montage. I'm all for it.
Yeah, I think that's it. They actually said they ended up having to cut a lot of time in this episode. They said they had a lot of extra stuff that got cut.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're getting ready for the fight, and Bender's down there, and he has like Leela, Fry, and Hermes down with him. There's a little joke where the other three, Amy, Zoidberg, and Professor up in the stands, and Amy gives Professor a program, and he puts on his reading glasses, which are like 8 inches thick. And he pulls up the thing, and they stab right through the program. He's like, Zoidberg, there's a lovely picture of you in here.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised they kept this joke if they cut a bunch of stuff.
Well, they said there was a whole subplot with the crew trying to do something to help Bender, and they're like, we cut that whole plot and added this joke.
Okay, that's fine then.
Yeah.
If they just decide to get rid of a whole subplot, then that makes it understandable.
Yeah, they said it was like 10 minutes.
Yeah, you can't have that. It was completely unnecessary.
Yeah, and, you know, Fnog and Leela end up meeting, and he's like, oh, funny, girl who acts like fighter, training fighter who acts like girl. You know, she's mad again.
Yeah.
But basically, she's doing this because she's mad at Fnog, and Fnog is still just as sexist as ever.
Yep.
And we have the announcers for it, and there's the head of George Foreman.
Yep.
And then also the head of Rich Little imitating Howard Cosell. So Rich Little was an actual comedian who did imitations, and Howard Cosell was a sports announcer.
Yep.
And they said originally they were just going to do the head of Howard Cosell, and then one of them, as a joke for them in the room, was like, be funny if we did it with Rich Little imitating Howard Cosell. So then they went with that, and it's actually Rich Little voicing him too.
That's pretty good. Well, most of the celebrities they get for these things, they get the actual person, but
yeah, the George Foreman is not actually George Foreman. It's John DiMaggio.
They weren't going to get George Foreman.
I just don't think he would get this type of thing.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I don't think it's worth it for them to chase after George Foreman.
He's been hitting the head a lot.
Too much.
He's named 5 of his kids George.
Yep.
Got 12 kids and I think 5 sons named George and a daughter named Georgina.
Yep.
So, you know.
Yeah. You got to avoid getting George Foreman at this point.
We get the fight getting ready to start. Leela's like, all right. She's reading the script. She's like, you're supposed to go out there and tickle him with your fairy wand. Or no, out there.
Tickle him with your fairy wand.
No, but there was something else too. You're supposed to prance out and tickle him with the fairy wand. She's like, instead, I want you to prance out and kick his head off. Because it was the prance. Because I knew she kept something.
Yeah.
But yeah, so then they get to the start of the fight. The ref's announcing them. And he's like, Destructor weighs like 400 tons or something.
And Bender was 500 pounds.
Yeah, Bender was 525 pounds, which is still quite a bit considering that like Leela like throws him around sometimes or they drag him.
It's like 6 feet of metal though. Like that's...
No, it makes sense. But it's just like, it's pretty heavy.
Yeah.
The other characters are pretty strong.
My thought is Destructor is 400 tons standing in that wrestling ring.
Yeah.
That's a strong wrestling ring.
Yeah.
400 tons is an obscene amount of weight.
Yeah. The round starts and Bender quickly like snaps his fairy wand and throws his wig off. And then he takes off the tutu, but he pulls out a little hanger from his chest and hangs it up real carefully and puts it back. Which I thought was funny. Like he's being so aggressive with the other things. And then.
Yeah. It's a weird little juxtaposition.
And he's, all now boarding passengers for a nonstop flight to pain. He like kicks Destructor and nothing happens. And he's like, now boarding standby passengers. And the Destructor just smashes him on the head.
Yeah. Essentially Bender starts to try, but it doesn't matter.
He's just getting the crap kicked out of him. He's getting like smashed around. They have him at one point. He gets like smashed on the ground and he's like, Fry, throw in the towel. And he gets pulled away, smashed down again. He's like, for God's sakes, Fry, throw in the towel. And Fry's just staring at him. And then he turns his head and he's got another brain slug on him.
Yeah.
So essentially he's not going to throw in the towel. He can't give up. And Leela looks to Fnog, yell at him to like call him off.
Yeah. Fight's over. Clearly your guy's beating Bender. Like, let's end this.
She just sees a little radar dish and he's not there. So she goes over to Wander and see what's happening. In the background, Bender still getting the crap kicked out of them. Oh, they talked in the commentary. In the front row, you can see like a bunch of the celebrity characters, like Calculon's there, the King of Trisol's there, Richard Nixon's there. They said there was a cut joke where Mom was there and she was gonna yell, make that bitch your bitch, you bastard.
I wish they would have kept that one, actually.
The censors didn't like that one.
No, I don't think so, but I like that joke. That's kind of funny.
Yeah, that didn't make it in, but that's too bad.
That's a good, that's a good Mom line. That would have been nice to have in.
And they have the stereotypical slow-mo black and white punch to the face that every boxing movie and show has ever done.
Yeah, teeth go flying out. He's bending everywhere.
Yeah, Leela gets over to Fnog's corner and he's not there. She sees the radar dish and she looks, follows a cord underneath the ring. And Fnog's in there in like a suit that like is letting him control Destructor, his little TV screen, so he can watch it. And she's like, you didn't train Destructor at all. It's like, you're just puppeting him, cheating in a fixed fight.
It makes no sense. It's the weirdest plot line decision, but that they address it, so it's kind of funny. But like, yeah, why are you cheating in a fixed fight? You don't need to do that.
Originally, I had thought it meant that Destructor wasn't actually a robot. Like, he was just a puppet machine thing, but he comes back later. He's an actual robot.
Yeah, so it's like, what is the whole point to this then? Like, no offense, but like, he didn't need to cheat for him to beat Bender. It was very clear that Bender couldn't hurt Destructor.
But she's like, yeah, you're just a cheater. And he's like, that's better than being a girl like you. You're a girl. Laughs at her. So then they start fighting and Leela's being super aggressive. So Fnog's just on the defense and he's like backing away, blocking. And then Bender realizes that's happening up top. And he's like, all right, it's Bender in time. And he starts swinging and stuff. He's never hitting Destructor though.
No, but he's full on faking it to make it look like he's hitting him.
Yeah. And then Fnog starts getting aggressive back towards Leela. So punching back, but he's actually hitting Bender though. And Bender's like, I think you misunderstood the meaning of Bender in time.
Yeah.
But Leela notices on the screen what's happening. She manages to grab Fnog's arm and punch it down through the floor and hit Fnog with like Destructor's giant arm.
Yeah, like Destructor's arm comes through the mat.
Yeah, and it knocks him out. He falls down. But then on the ring, Destructor falls down onto Bender and the ref comes out and he just does the count and he's like, the winner is Destructor, holds up the giant arm and then it crushes the ref.
Which I mentioned, like, that's a strong ref alien because even if it's just one arm, the 400 tons, like, that's gotta be like at least 3 tons.
You'd think so. Maybe the arms are like no weight.
Yeah, all in the torso.
And, you know, they kept showing the announcers, too, throughout this, and they get to this basically being the end. We missed, actually, one good joke at the beginning, before the fight, where they're talking about, it's like, the Vegas odds against Bender are 1,000 to 0. So a bet of $0 on Bender pays $1,000 if he wins. Like, still not a lot of takers.
And George Farmer's going, that's not a good bet.
Yes, not a good bet.
$0, still not a good bet.
It doesn't make sense. Everyone should be making that bet.
But that's how bad the fight is. It's like, even if it's free, it's not a bet worth taking.
Yeah, so they, you know, they cut to later, and Destructor's body's been removed and Bender's just literally flat. Like, yeah, he's like two-dimensional. And Fry's there and he's like, Bender, how'd the fight go? I heard someone got flattened. Amy's just like, hey Fry, what happened to your brain slug? Professor like picks it up off the ground. He's like, poor little thing, starved to death.
A great little joke about how dumb Fry is. He's so dumb that brain slugs can't feed off of him.
Yeah, and then Leela's trying to say, it's like, it's okay. It's like, Bender did his best, you know, he can have pride in that. And she's like, and anyways, the most important thing is I got to beat up someone who made me feel bad in high school.
Yeah.
And Bender's just like, I'm in tremendous pain. And Abner Double Deal comes up. He's like, good work, Bender. You actually made it look real. So as payment, here's your 10% off coupon for Bed Bath & Beyond. And he like opens Bender's compartment and puts it in and leaves. And Bender's just like, yay, I'm the greatest.
Yeah, and then they roll him up into a little ball and they get on out of there.
Yeah, and that's the end of the episode here. I like this one. It's not one of my favorites. I gave it an 82.
I gave it an 86. I do like this one more so than most. It's not one that I watch a lot, and it's definitely not one of my favorites, but it's one that when it popped up, like, it's got a lot of good jokes and a lot of good moments to it. I think all three acts work quite well together. Like, they structurally are sound.
Yeah,
it's got a bunch of good jokes. It's got,
well, what'd you give it as your best joke?
I like it when Bender's getting beat up and he just watches Leela leave. It's probably the same as what your best joke is, because you didn't bring it up, and he's just in pain going, why won't anyone help me?
Oh yeah, yeah, no, I was a similar one, but yeah, that's a good one. Leela's walking by and he's just getting stomped by Destructor.
Why won't anyone help me? Yeah. Essentially, he's been calling for help for like, I don't know, 2 or 3 minutes, and no one's doing anything to stop this.
Yeah, because I actually went with basically the preceding joke to that one, where he's getting smashed by Destructor and he's like, Fry, throw in the towel, and then gets pulled away and smashed on the second time. He's like, for God's sakes, Fry.
Yeah, essentially just nobody helping Bender is good.
It's essentially the same joke. We just picked different moments in it.
Literally, I picked the moment afterwards. They're like, why won't anyone help me?
Yeah, it's great that he's just getting the crap kicked out of him and no one's doing anything.
Nope.
Yeah, I think, like I said, I think this is a good one. I like a lot of the character introductions, like all the different robot wrestlers are pretty fun.
Mm-hmm. I think we said this one of the last few episodes, but like, I do think the strength of each episode is based on the supporting characters, like, yeah, outside of the Planet Express one. And I think this one had enough good jokes in its minor characters that it makes it stand out.
Yeah, I think it helps a lot for sure, getting good secondary characters.
Yeah.
Not a lot of them really came out of this one as important characters.
No, like you mentioned that billionaire bot shows up a good amount, but not really. That's like a main thing anyway.
Yeah, Destructor and like Abner Double Deal all come back again at least once in like a fairly significant way.
Yeah, but there again, it's nothing like a Zap Brannigan sort of thing.
No. And I mean, you know, there's going to be a lot less of those as it goes on, right?
But I still thought it worked really well. I was a big fan of this one.
Yeah, like I said, I enjoy this one as well. It's not a favorite, but it's a nice solid episode. It's very standalone. It's just, you know, its own thing.
Yep. Watch it and mix with any season and it works still well.
Pretty much. Yeah. You can watch this at just about any point throughout the series. Yeah. So feel free to let us know what you think about this episode, what you liked about it. If you didn't like it, you can comment on YouTube where this is posted, or you can follow us on Twitter at C with Nerds. That's CWITHNERDS. And next week we'll be reviewing A Bicyclops Built for Two.
Can't wait.
Yeah. So we'll see you all then. And thank you, everybody, and goodbye.
Goodbye.